boys singing a song, and there's nothing better, gentlemen, than to beat Carlton, especially to come from behind. The best time was when Dicko kicked the goal after the siren, but that's up there. Bards?
It was good, mate. Unfortunately, I wasn't there, as we know, but watching the bar, I was fairly quiet sitting in the corner. There's a few noisy ones in the bar, not Hawthorn or Carlton supporters, but they like to give it to me no matter what. And they all shut up quick smart as we started getting on top there, mate, and lovely to run out winners.
Adam, what did you think from afar?
I've got to be honest, and whilst it's great to beat Carlton and we continue to beat them, I thought Carlton played really well, if I'm honest, and I thought that we got a little bit lucky late in the game with some umpiring decisions, but, you know, at the end of the day, 10-1, you're not going to be able to win by 10 goals every week, so you bank the 4 points and you move on.
And Clarko was smiling his head off, wasn't he? His little big buffet.
He was very happy. Maybe he was happy with the umpire.
Not often he smiles, but he had a big smirk on his face after that one.
Maybe someone had told him that Nita just been sacked. Apparently that happened Friday night.
Well, do you think he might be a chance for the job given Jeff's going for presidency?
No, but I think it'll help his bargaining position with Hawthorn for an extension.
Fair enough. Some scores.
Yes, mate. Hawthorn 15-12-102 to Carlton 13-9-87, running out 15-point winners.
Goal kickers.
Franklin 4, Roughhead 4, Gunston 3, 1 to Mitchell, and 1 to the Triple H's. Hale, Hodge and Hill.
Hey, is it possible that we could have dual Coleman medalists from Hawthorn in the 1 year?
No, because I don't think any of them are going to finish in front of the rest of them.
Don't think so? They're just good, honest 4 or 5 goal week toilers.
As diversity, the forward line's doing a great job. And look, to see Gunston with 3 as well there, you know, I think our first 4 goals were Franklin, Roughhead, Gunston and Hale. That's going to be half a team to match up on when those blokes can all get amongst it. So, very good.
I've never heard Buddy Franklin described as a good 4 or 5 goal a week toiler.
I have now, so they don't want him.
He's not worth $10 million, he's just a toiler.
Toiler? I think he likes to lay something, but it's not tiles.
Hey, Buds, are you impressed with the Wizards listening to our show? Did you see the quote that I put up?
I did see that. After you said last week that you should talk to the Wiz about going to a shit team, and Wiz writes in the paper that he shouldn't go to a shit team.
Yeah, so we must get the Wiz on the program.
We've obviously dropped our intellect if he's listening, though.
You want to track down the Wiz?
No, I don't want to track down the Wiz. I've missed Open Mic this week too, and I think he's on there, isn't he?
Yeah, that's where the quote's from, actually.
Is it really? Yeah, I haven't seen it this week, but yeah. He's a funny guy.
Oh, I have that on Series Link. I'll be looking forward to watching that.
All right, well, we've got to get into the votes, Bards. This 5 votes are going to be very, very interesting, I reckon, after the game.
Mate, to be honest, it was one of the harder games I've done votes for. I think when you're watching a game, you're behind, you're sort of picking out all the negatives, and then all of a sudden we've got up on one. I'm like, well, what caused that? So I've done these. They could go either way, but this is the way I've done them, and they're staying that way. So I've gone 5 to my man, Birchall. Thought he ran hard all game off the back line. His ball usage was excellent again. I didn't turn it over much and had a good game. We're going 4 to Brian Lake. I thought him getting on top in the second half especially was what turned the game. I think he had 5 or 6 intercept marks. You know, from we've been a side that just punches the ball out a lot, and him taking those marks, it relieves a hell of a lot of pressure. So 4 to Lake. 3 to Hodge. Big game from Hodge. He just kept throwing that body around. You know, sort of put the pressure on when he had to. Kicked a nice goal towards the end as well. 2 to Franklin. This guy gets overlooked sometimes because we expect him to be kicking 6 or 7, but 4 goals. He had 120 on Supercoach points, which is a good indication of his work rate and what else he's doing on the ground. I thought he was good. And 1 to Mitchell for just accumulating lots of ball again, lots of clearances, of which we didn't have many, and he had the most, and yeah, used it fairly well.
Well, as a result of that, Birchall's out on 24. That's 24 Bardless low votes, and Hodgie's on 21.
I should have gone for odds to get Birchall in the Bards low instead of the Brown low. I probably got him over the line.
Andrew Dimitro might be investigating that, if that was the case, Bards.
Quite possibly.
Right. Righto, well, it's time for a blast.
All right, mate, blast this week. It's pretty short and it's simple. Channel 7. How many times do we have to see footage of Mark Murphy getting into an ambulance? Seriously, you'd think the guy had a heart attack on the ground and we're worried about his safety. And he wasn't even an emergency ambulance. It was a patient transport vehicle. It could have been the backseat of his old man's car taking him to the hospital for a checkup. Get back to the footy. That's what we're paying you to watch.
And the observation everyone made was, where was Doc Larkins? If you're going to go to the ambulance, at least have the doctor there.
She wasn't running around on the ground in a blue jumper, was she?
No, apparently that was our doctor.
I'm interested on that topic. What colour do the Carlton doctors wear when they run on the ground? Blue. And how often do they kick it to them? Never.
Is that a fair suck of the Sav? Fair suck of the Sav, Carlton? Are you just stupid?
That little tummy bloke in the long sleeve jacket. He looks like a Carlton footballer, apparently.
Well, we're onto a whack.
Boys, Mick Malthouse, I don't know whether you caught his rather petulant and churlish interview with Richo after the game, but I noted today that Luke Hodge was cleared of any wrongdoing in the clash with Mark Murphy and accepted a reprimand for the Henderson clash, but Malthouse after the game all but insinuated that Luke Hodge virtually deliberately went high at Murphy and was rather upset at the umpiring surrounding that incident. The fact that Hodge was cleared of any wrongdoing tells you, Mr. Malthouse, that you're clearly losing the plot. It was a disgraceful effort from a senior coach on national television.
Oh. Richo looked bewildered, didn't he?
Richo didn't know which way to go there. You know, they lost a game of footy and, you know, he probably had some gripe over some of the umpiring, but certainly the Luke Hodge, well, I wouldn't even say it was a hit on Mark Murphy. I think it was two courageous footballers putting their heads over the football. For Mick Malthouse to insinuate that Hodge was anything but legitimate is nothing short of disgraceful.
Yeah, he was way off the mark there, and he copped a right whack in online Facebook, and everything went into meltdown, calling him a sook, and rightly so. Right, right, you're bloody well right, you got a bloody right to say. Right, you're bloody well right,
you know you got a right to say. Hey, he's verging on fair suck of the Sav as well, but here's my fair suck of the Sav. And that is, I didn't press red for blues. Fair suck of the Sav. Did I need to put up with Bruce crapping on about Mark Murphy, Chris Judd? If I wanted to press blue, I would have pressed the buttons for the adult channel. Fair suck of the Sav.
Oh, I love your work, Grant. Love your work.
I saw another note, very impressive note. We've got three teams on top of the ladder.
We have. Did you see that post I put up?
Yep. Adam, see that one?
That is outstanding, isn't it? It tells you that this club that we all follow with passion is headed in exactly the direction that we want it headed in.
It's like the old days of the McClellan Trophy. You get to the game and check the record and see who the best club is overall, and that's us at the moment.
Yep.
So, how do the boys go? Who's pressuring the senior team now, Bart?
Oh, look, just looking at the best. Obviously, didn't see the game, but looking at the best. Banger had another good game. Obviously, he's there as backup for the big bloke, so he's not pressuring to get in. Cheney apparently went back and was really good. Whitecross, first game back, just solid, they said. Struggled with the pace a little bit, but getting used to it. Alice was amongst it again, but didn't set the world on fire. So, and Hallahan was very good. And he'd be an outside chance for a game later in the year if they just want to rest someone. So I think Clarko sort of set a 30 that we've seen most of so far. But look, there's blokes there that are still playing good footy. And folks like Hallahan and Langford, they're probably a little bit stiff. They haven't got an opportunity. Any other club, they probably would have by now. But when you're 10-1, you don't mess with things too much. So there's a bit of depth there, and it's looking good.
Just a quick one on that. I noticed a name that I think, not that you omitted, Bars, that you didn't mention. It was Grimley, and I thought, didn't think Friday night was Big Maxie's best game. I thought Cruiser well and truly beat him the other night. Do you think Grimley's a chance of maybe taking Big Maxie's spot later in the season?
I don't think so, personally. I think we're judging Grimley on two good good games against average opposition. Bailey's played a couple of rippers this year against good sides as well. Grimley's ruck work, even in the Melbourne game against Jamo, who's a decent ruckman, I'll admit, but he struggled at centre bounces as well. He adds a bit more around the ground. I think he's more of a second backup to Hale type. You know, he can go forward, do a bit there, and be the second ruck. I think Bailey's important to us when he's playing well. I already had a bad game the other night, but he's got runs on the board this year, so at this stage, I don't think there's too much pressure there, but he looks like being a handy backup, and then he will eventually make his way into the side, obviously.
Fair enough.
Hello, Bards. Well, it's time for After an Eventful Day in Your Life from the Backline.
All right, mate, Hawthorn versus West Coast, Etihad Stadium, 7:50 tomorrow night, Friday night, for those of you listening on Friday. And from the back line, it's Stratton, Lake and Guerra, halfbacks Birchall, Gibson and Luke Hodge. The centre line is Savage, Mitchell and Hill. Half forwards, Pioppolo, Franklin and Lewis. The forward line is Hale, Ruffett and Bruce. The ruck division is Bailey, Burgoyne and Sewell. And the interchange, Duray, Gunston, Shields and Simpkin. Emergencies, Cheney, Ellis and Spanger. So coming into the side, we have Shane Savage. And going out is Isaac Smith.
The macho man is back. All right, well, on to this week's game. Another Friday night game, challenging to us all. It's actually a home game, but at Etihad Stadium. How do we win this one?
I'll let you go first here, Adam.
Well, look, I think, obviously, got to, almost impossible to do. We're not going to be able to negate the ruck against the Eagles. Cox and Nat Nui are probably the two best big men running around. That said, I think we control the stoppages and start to shark a few of the taps from the locks of Cox and so forth, and just control the midfield. I think they've got a couple of very good midfielders, but Pritis and Luke Shuey and Andrew Gaff, they're good B-grade midfielders in my view, and I think our top end is a bit better than theirs. I just think we win the contested footy and we win the game. I don't see the Eagles troubling us in Melbourne.
My notes here, the first line was where we win it, not in the ruck, which obviously is what you've said. Look, we're down on clearances on the weekend. I think we can fix that. The boys will be pretty keen. They definitely don't bat as deep in the midfield as we do. They've got a couple of top liners, like you said, but they fall away. And look, their strength against us last year was more so their tall forwards. I think with Lake back there, it helps a lot. He should be able to sort of take Kennedy or Darwin, whichever one stays closer to goal, and Gibbo will pick up the other. They haven't got Lynch, that probably troubled us a bit last year as well, so I think we're right there. And I think up forward, I don't think they've got enough to match our firepower. You know, even if Glass does a job on Franklin, there's who takes Ruffett, who takes Gunston. And Bruce, I don't think, will have a bad game like he did on Friday night, 2 weeks in a row. So I reckon the big fella might be due, though, Franklin. I reckon it could be 7 goals in him this week. Just got a feeling under the roof he might explode. Hope so. But yeah, I think, like in Melbourne, I think we're just too strong.
So where does margin?
33 points.
Bards?
36.
Yeah, I'm going for 5 goals, so we're all thereabouts. So we better go while this has been a buddy speculation-free show.
Yeah, that sounds like a good idea.
All right, so go Hawks.
Go Hawks.